it's a hell of a journey, bro. It's crazy because even just now, the having to think and talk through it, it sounds wild. But when we had to leave Hair Junkies, it was a very impromptu situation.
It was right before Philby's event. So, like, yeah, June of 2022. So about a year I was there. Like a year and some months, you know?
The vibe that was in there, visually and everything, was like, damn, where can you go from here? And once me and Gonzo realized that we had to leave there, we found ourselves looking at each other kind of like, hey, now what?
Elevate, elevate.
We coming.
Only up. Obligation is to tell it straight. So much on my plate, I gotta delegate. Baco pass a drug, cause we gotta celebrate. I'm in bed awake, thinking how'd I make. All this happened for myself and my family. All this happened for myself and my family. There's no way that this is real, man, it can't be. Yeah.
What is it, left? This left?
Yeah. I don't think so, but
nope,
yeah, it'll work.
No, oh, yeah, it will work. Yep.
Yeah, it'll work. Yeah, it'll work. That'll be fine.
Yeah. Tell me about how that idea started, the name started.
Yeah.
How did you come up with the name?
So the name came about, obviously, the same week that I asked him if he wants to open up a shop or he wants to buy this shop, because we were supposed to buy a shop in downtown. That didn't work out, but we were brainstorming, you know? So we sat down at Harry's, you know, and I think we had a phone call first. And he was like, I have a few names, but what do you think about Elevate Barbering?
Elevate Barbering was actually one of the first two or three ideas I had. When I gave him the Elevate Barbering idea, he was kind of feeling it. And then I went and had the logo done and the idea, we kind of tossed around ideas for that. And then the more we started to see it like physically, it started to kind of build into its own thing where I was like, oh shit, this is it.
And I was like, I love it, bro. You know me, I'm open to any type of new ideas, and me, I'm not as creative, or I don't have a name that I can, you know, I'm stuck to, you know.
I'm happy to say that Gonzo gave me a lot of creative freedom when it came to what we wanted to establish for the shop, because he knows I'm kind of more on like the quote unquote artsy vibe. Like I like to be kind of crazy, creative and stuff.
I felt like it was perfect, and the reasoning behind it and the purpose behind it fell in line, you know? So once he explained it to me, what his vision was, I was like, let's run with it.
Came to choosing the toolboxes for stations, I already had an idea because I had worked at a shop before that used toolboxes. Even before then, I love the idea of toolboxes as a barbershop thing. I just think it fits perfectly well. I love the idea, the vibe, the space, how much it provides.
You know, I love these toolboxes and they're efficient, they work. So we knew we needed the toolbox, we know we needed the chair. Then everything else is what you need, like little stuff, like barber mats.
First and foremost, the important thing was the chairs. The quality of our barber chairs, after being at 3 or 4 different shops and seeing the various different levels, was like, bro, we need to have premium chairs. Like, that. If that's the most expensive thing in the shop, it is what it is, but that's gotta happen.
What we needed to find out was what color. We figured out, I bought a white chair for the other shop. He was like, oh, we gotta do white. White chairs is fire. This is different. You know, you don't see white chairs in a barbershop.
We kind of already knew we were going with the color scheme. Like, we knew it was gonna be a lot of black, we knew it was gonna be a lot of white, and the white had to pop.
So we knew we wanted white chairs. All right, now we're going back to the theme. We're trying to figure out, is the chair, do we want a typical barber chair? You know, a typical white barber chair, or do we want a barber chair that you might see on a spaceship?
And then the lean back. Oh, we sit in it and lean it back for yourself.
Smooth too?
Yeah.
Oh, You know, something chrome, something sleek, modern, you know? So that when that decision making went hand in hand with the theme. And it was different, you know, we're trying to set ourselves apart. We know we wanted a black couch, black furniture, because we're gonna have black walls, you know? So we knew what we kind of needed. It was just planning it, picking it out, agreeing upon it, then getting it. Couch was like, we either buy something retail or we find something on like Marketplace or something like that, but we wanted something new, so we got a new section, you know, something affordable, something durable, because there's gonna be a lot of hair, a lot of cleaning products on it, so yeah, so we figured that out pretty quick.
What, at 500?
Yeah.
Okay, so we'll just take 200 off. Do you guys do military discounts? It's American free.
I can say the tax on it.
Let's do it.
It works.
Five balls in military.
Yeah, for real.
Yeah, man.
Yeah.
Appreciate you. Navy.
Not that we want to really, you know, use that, but if it comes, it saves us some money.
Yeah, we appreciate your service, for real.
Yeah, I just put the couch together right now. I just sat my ass down on it. I got a barber shop with 1, 2, 3, 4, technically 5 panes of window, but like 2 are small, 1 is on the door. And we just want to get some tint for that, where, you know, there's a design on the front, but you can't really see through it.
Right, yeah, the first window. We probably have to come out and survey the windows and get exact measurements to get you an exact quote.
I have those measurements, if that would help.
And I'm excited. I get here and I'm excited. I was like, oh shit, the tint is done, the perf is done, we got the windows. And I get out of my truck and I see it, and it's not as seamless as he said it was going to be.
And he tried to blame me on the phone saying that I called you yesterday. I'm not even fucking arguing.
Yeah, that's not worth it. Just get the shit done, bro.
And honestly, at this price point, like, we're still fucking winning. Yeah. So it's like, whatever.
The measurements was completely backwards, not correct at all.
Whatever the height is the width now, and the width was the height. So he had to redo the perf. And he was like, oh, I ran out of material. So now we gotta wait for the material to get on there.
So one of the windows, like the seams was all messed up. There's a huge gap. Then the next time they showed up, they were correct, but it wasn't applied correctly. Then they missed one window completely. They just forgot that window needed any kind of graphic.
To me, his reaction, I didn't think that he was gonna fix it if I didn't say anything.
It's just been a mess. It's like trivial stuff where it's like, you're a business. You're actually a business who makes money in this town.
It was just a lot of unnecessary obstacles that could have just been a job that was done simple if he would have conducted business properly. So whenever we signed the lease, we had a preliminary inspection. So the preliminary inspection pretty much tells you what you need to do in this place of business to operate as a business. You need your plumbing. That's to be legal as a barbershop. You need a shampoo sink. You know, you need a hot water heater attached to the shampoo sink. We know that with the city that you have to place a permit, so you have to get a licensed plumber. So we knew we needed those things before we got the actual shop.
Yeah, we had to do everything from day one with no power because of the fact that we had to have a hair wash sink in here. So the city wouldn't give us power until this job was done. And the job wasn't gonna be done for pretty much till everything was done. Could we do it today?
We don't think so.
So it was a lot of waiting around for that, because we thought at first that the plumbing was all we needed to get done. We got the plumbing done, we go to the city, and we get to the city and they say, oh, okay, that's cool, you got your plumbing done, you got the permit done, we see that. plumbing inspection came out great. We thought we were good. We thought we were ready to conduct business.
And then I will set you up for an electrical inspection, but it's not going to be today.
Can it be temporarily done?
Can we have temporary power for now? We have to be in there, and I have my business is supposed to be open tomorrow, because everything that you guys have told me to do, I've done, and I have appointments for tomorrow ready to go, because this inspection is the last inspection that we were ever told about.
We get there and they say, okay, you need an electrical permit now. An electrical inspector has to inspect the place to see if it's safe for the public or not.
Why I don't understand why everyone's acting so casual about just giving us power. We have the money to pay for it. We've done everything you guys have asked us. We just need the electric power turned on.
Every business is not—it's not guaranteed all the time.
So if you want to have a seat, we're going to see if we can find someone who can come out when he has availability in their schedule.
That would be fantastic. Okay, thank you. Yes.
And we basically just had to wade through all that, and then once it was finally done, we had to go finally get power on.
Came down here because it was cheaper, it was a better living. We were out in the hood in Brooklyn, you know, and I don't remember too much of it, but from what they say, it was bad, you know. We came here with no other family, you know, so we came down here and we made a home for ourselves. I pretty much claim Florida because I don't really remember before 8 years old too much. You know, I remember some glimpses, but everything after that, I remember. So growing up, it was good because it was totally different than what we were actually used to. The schools in New York were all in a dull-ass building, you know? And we get out here and the schools are outside. You have to walk outside the buildings to get to your next class. I think growing up in Wildwood actually, it helped me grow as a person, and it was fun, you know. I had friends that had like dirt bikes, mini dirt bikes. We would go out. I had friends that had like snakes and stuff. It's totally different than what you see in like a Puerto Rican household. You have a lot more like white friends, black friends, you know, those cultures, you know, influencing the person that you are. You know, I have a lot of friends, so I was able to experience a bunch of different families. That diversity, being able to interact with any kind of culture, you know, that formed my childhood. And, you know, being able to fit in any kind of crowd, you know, fit in with different crowds that you see in school, you know. I was one of those that I could talk to anybody. Kicking it with like the neighborhood kids, you know, like my best friends growing up, be outside, ride bikes, you know, typical childhood stuff. Mainly though, Call of Duty, video games, that was my shit. And then playing sports, basketball, shit. Right after school, I would be hanging out with my friends all the way up until it got dark, and then it was time to go back to school, you know. I got a job whenever I was 15 at McDonald's. McDonald's was my first job, literally my first job, because that's the only, well, Publix used to hire like 15-year-olds, but back then it was hard to get a job at Publix. That was like one of those jobs that everybody wanted, and every kid knew that they could apply there, you know. So McDonald's hired me right off rip, so kept me busy, because at that time I was getting into trouble, and I was, you know, just being a shithead in school, pretty much. And I turned 16 and I was able to get a job at Firehouse Subs. Yeah, my brother plugged me in. He was the manager there. So yeah, they hooked me up, they put me on there, and I worked that job until I went to the military. My first assignment was shore duty, which is not really heard of. Usually you gotta go to the ship, your first assignment. But I got sent to Bethesda, Maryland. It's a little town right outside D.C., Washington, D.C. I ran the help desk techs. My coworkers were civilians, they were contractors. They were some people else. So it was like a regular workplace. But I'm here in my navy blues or my camos, whatever, you know. The only traveling I really did was we would go out to the field in Pennsylvania. So there we did like a simulation-based field training. What I played was the radio men. I was actually reading off a script and they would have to tell me the coordinates of where they were, and it was fun. It was pretty much like acting, you know? I really had a day job in the military, you know? It was pretty sweet what I got in return after the military, but I wish I would have experienced the actual military and being out in the fleet and being on a ship. And that's all the stuff that I did join the military for. So I had to change my focus, switch focus, and, you know, deal with what they give you. You know, that's what you have to deal with. You can't say no.
I was born in New York, but I was raised in Orlando or Kissimmee, Florida, for most people who know where that is. So I was raised there from when I was a kid, like 1 year old, I moved there. And that's where I grew up. I love my childhood, man. I had a great childhood. We grew up with my friends, hanging out, playing games. I didn't really have any major hobbies. Like now I have tons of hobbies, like official hobbies. Whereas back then, video games and sports and just hanging out with my friends. Like I think social interactions was my hobby. Back then I'm just trying to hang out with my people, you know? Out with all my friends, all types of friends, parties. I played baseball, most of my friends play basketball. So growing up from like 4 years old all the way through school, I mostly played that. I had a great time growing up, and then of course going to parties and hanging out meant you had to have a fresh cut. So I started working at a barbershop when I was 13. Spot, at that time it was called Hot Spot Barbershop. Now I believe they're called the Fade Factory. Basically grew up in that barbershop. I started sweeping up hair at like 13. And after a couple weeks or months working there, my pops got me my mom and my dad got me a pair of clippers. And then I started cutting up my little brother, his friends. Then I moved on to my friends. And that's pretty much what got me into the game of barbering, staying fresh for hanging out. Everybody knows, right, when you hit 14, 15, you're trying to apply at Publix because it's the first place you can go to get a job, like trying to get some money. I had to find something under the table, so I just went up to the owner one day and was like, hey, you think I can sweep up hair here for you guys, make some money? And then they said, yeah, and I was like, all right, bet, I got a job. I'm working at the barbershop, so. I'm just hanging out, talking to you like this, and then when I see there's too much hair on the floor, sweeping it up. And then after sweeping up, you're just in that environment. It just kind of grows on you. Man, I want to say some days I left there with like $200 from one day. At that time, I wasn't thinking about, oh, I want to cut hair, I want to be a barber. I was just making some money at the barbershop. After that, I worked, I believe, doing valet. I did valet in high school, and then I also worked at Cold Stone Creamery in high school, which were two amazing jobs for their own reasons.
See, a little red button is going off. It's your boy, Philby. You know where I'm at. Missing the helmet cover, but it's all good. Cause I'm G.I. Philby. So we're about to get on this plane in a couple hours.
My experience in the military was an interesting one and one I appreciate. However, if I had to tell you if I enjoyed my time in the military, my heart and gut tells me every time no. I didn't enjoy it. My number one reason for going to the military in general was getting money for school. And then I would say my closest second reason was life experience.
It's a good day.
I don't really like my experience in the military overall, but I can think about a bunch of amazing times and experiences and moments that I cherish through that experience. But I feel like it's like with anything, when you're going through a large struggle of whatever nature, it's gonna come with its beautiful moments along the way.
8-9 hours. That was the gayest wave I've ever seen, probably.
One time they were testing out the engine of an F-22, and me and a buddy of mine, who has passed since then actually, got to go and actually hold on to this F-22 engine while they were testing it out. And we got to hang on to the railing. We had like the pilot helmet on and all that. And we got to hang on to the railing and watching them turn the afterburners on, where you see like a huge beam of light, like like Iron Man flying through this tunnel. The craziest times would be like in Afghanistan, like being deployed in a live war zone, getting attacked, like having bombs go off, mortars, like actively being attacked as a base in a war zone. Like that just, it sounds like a movie, like I'm playing a video game, but it's like I know I was really there and actually lived that. And there was a couple nights that still to this day give me chills when I think about the details of being there. For me, if somebody asked me if they should go in or not, like I would tell them, if you think you should or you're curious about it, do it. Because if you think you should join the military or you want to know what it's like, there's only one way to know the answer. There's only one way to figure it out, and that's doing it. Nothing else in the world will ever give you the satisfaction of the curiosity than just doing it. I got out for freedom, man. I got to the point where at the end, I was waking up every day just hating what I was about to wake into. Like, I literally was waking up thinking, like, with the first thought, like, I open my eyes and I'm just like, fuck.
I decided not to re-enlist because there wasn't a need to re-enlist. You know, I put all my ducks in order that I didn't need the military anymore.
The sense of freedom that you fight for in the military, to me, I felt like I felt a lot less free being in the military.
If I had to go back and do it all over again, I would choose the military every time. Because the place I was in, I was lost and I didn't know what to do with my life.
Even if you hate it, 4 years of doing a job you don't like, most people do like 30, 40 years of a job they don't like.
Just to give you that little push in your life that you need and that I needed at the time to really mature me and give me structure.
And to know that I had to start building the life that I could wake up and feel good about my day. Like I might be busy, I might have a lot going on, but I'm not miserable about the day I'm about to have to work through. That for me, that's how I knew I had to get out.
I started my job as a contractor, government contractor, with the same company I was with in the military. So I made it so that I was able to telework from Florida, because at the time my eldest daughter was born. She was born in 2017. So I had to be in Florida because her mom was in Florida. So I was like, either I take this job and go to Florida, or I don't take the job at all and I still go to Florida, you know? And they gave me the job, they let me telework, and I came back to Florida, you know, to, you know, raise my kid.
I actually went into a flight school program because I wanted to be a pilot. And then I realized through that course that the career field was pretty similar to the military. So I was like, you know what, that I had fun learning how to fly planes, but I don't think that's for me either. So then I ended up branching off into the business. Just there's many business ideas I have and things I want to do. So I was like, all right, this is going to apply to everything I want to do. At the time I was working with Chewy.com, the online pet store. And they were just opening up the warehouse here in Ocala. I was finding out that we had our first kid on the way, and it was like, all right, so we ended up moving up here. I helped them launch that building. And after just a couple years, and I maybe had one or two people that I might've cut their hair, but after a couple years of working in that at that job, which I had a great time, it was just, I realized that I was going down the same path as the military, where it was like, if you don't just figure out your own thing to control your own life and your own time and do what you really want to do, it's not gonna happen. And I already know how to cut hair. The only thing stopping me from doing that is that I don't have my license.
I had to do something. I had to go and do something that was going to push me forward in life and pay me at the same time. What got me into barbering was I came back to Florida, I was teleworking, I had all this time. One of my best friends, Mitri, you know, he's my barber now, and I see he's killing it. You know, he's probably like 2 years in the game at that point, and he's booked up, he's getting his money, you know, and I was like, maybe I could take up barbering.
So I went back to barber school, left my job, started hustling with life insurance, health insurance, just to make ends meet, and it was like, all right, if I don't start it now, I'm not gonna have my own barber shop, I'm not gonna be able to do everything else, so had to make it happen. Dude, Gonzo, that's a funny guy. Yeah, no, I met him in barber school. I remember the first day just because it was so memorable.
The earliest memory I have of Philby that he's obviously Philby and he's talking, you know, and it's the first day of school, so everybody's like meeting each other, you know.
And I had cut my dreadlocks from the time off, so I had short military haircut type, and I was dressing in a shirt and tie.
And obviously he's probably one of the loudest there. He's talking to everybody. And he has this suit. I think it was like a purple shirt. I want to say it was like a purple shirt. That's crazy that this is the colors now. It's like a purple shirt or some fucking, you know, girly ass shirt. Who knows?
And I'd come to work. I'd be the only one in like a shirt and tie. Everybody's mad casual. And then Gonzo's over here got bright green, like the brightest green, lime green hair you could imagine. But he got a fresh cut though. Like the cut is fresh. So I'm like, all right.
They're probably thinking it's crazy because at that time, I had green hair, bright lime green hair, you know, this Puerto Rican fucking, you know, yeah, I got a Supreme backpack, you know, it's like, I'm like a hype beast. I'm like a typical Puerto Rican barber, you know what I'm saying?
And I think this is like the, I want to say the beginning of the Bad Bunny era, so I'm like, oh, okay, I know who this guy is, bro.
But his business attire, he had these slacks, he had dress shoes on. You know, and we're going to barber school, you know, and he's like real professional. So I asked him, I was like, bro, you a realtor or something? He was like, no, I sell insurance. I was like, that makes a lot of sense. I was like, you look like a salesman. He's still the same person as he was then, just a lot more hair.
Obviously, you know, the humor, you gotta have humor. You gotta have good vibes. You know, I think the reason that we're as successful as we've been so far is just because he reminds me we do similar things. Like, we both have families.
We were both in the military, both Puerto Rican, we're both barbers, we're both trying to do something, you know. We all had our separate vision of what, you know, our careers would be, but it's also the same goal of completing school and
be able to be our own person, but also establish an empire for us and the people we love around us.
And we got through it together, you know?
We didn't really hang out for real, me and Gonzo, for a good while. Like, it was mostly just school stuff. And then slowly but surely over a while, maybe like after a year of being in class.
He grabbed his
The first day, the first.
You gotta see them every day. You gotta see how they work, you see how they operate. And then we talk and then we get to know each other now. Now
the more you get opened up to different aspects of them, like it's like, okay, you only know this person through this one activity, then all of a sudden you get exposed to maybe their family and then to what they do outside of that and then how they operate as a person. So
the friendships obviously develop because now you're talking more and they see how you act, and I think that's how we became good friends. We've seen how each other operated, and it was love every time.
First barbershop I ever worked at as a licensed barber is, I believe, the same one that Gonzo ever worked at as a licensed barber, and it was FLA Fades. That was a quality experience.
It was exciting. My girlfriend, she's a barber, you know, so she was excited for me. I'm excited because we're both barbers at this point.
I knew what I was going into at the time. I'm very appreciative. Izzo is the owner of that shop. Izzo and Gio ran it. And they were real cool dudes. Learned a lot from them.
I was just excited to get out in the field, you know, get out and start cutting.
Then when Gonzo joined us over there, that's when it became four of us over there, and it was just a vibe, man.
We were at a hood shop. It was a small shop, like I want to say like 200 square foot.
And it was a small, like we have a pretty small shop now, But that shop is way smaller. If this barber chair, if I turned it left and I turned the one next to it right at the same time, your feet might hit each other, like that close, bro. And it was a great time.
That was a like a very anxious moment, like actually like cutting your first clients and, you know, getting all those jitters out, because you're scared at first, you know?
I don't even remember the first haircut I did in the barbershop. I had already cut hair for so long before, and you would think that that means that I'm uber confident and like I already got it in the bag, da da da, but really, if anything, I felt like, damn, I've been cutting since I was 13 and I feel like I'm starting fresh, like if I never cut hair in my life before. All of the haircuts, which has been hundreds of haircuts before becoming a licensed barber, to me, that was just like doodling. Now I start cutting professionally with a full license and it's like, no, this is the real game.
Getting that, you know, that certificate of you're ready to go, you got your L's, you're official now, you're legit.
Like, I can imagine it would be similar to an NBA player getting drafted to the NBA and then starting playing in the NBA, and it's like, oh, this is basketball. Like, everything I've ever played before was child's play, literally. This is the real thing.
My barber did a no-call, no-show, and that's when Philby was brand new to the store, and he was like, hey, man, just sit in my chair. And I was like, first of all, bro, I've never seen you before, bro. You don't look like you can cut hair. Look like you surf, like this isn't the type of area you would see somebody like, bro, he had long hair, curly. He just like didn't look like he was from Bellevue. I've never seen him before, let alone look like he cuts hair. Cause like to me, everybody that cuts hair kind of looks sharp. Philby had long dreaded hair. I was like, okay, well.
As soon as they have to think about whether or not you're confident about it, now their mind starts going wild. You need to act like it don't matter who's sitting in my chair, my shit's raw and you're gonna be fucking sexy when you get up out of here.
All right, well, I'm gonna sit in your chair and we're gonna see what happens from here on out. And dude, I sat in his chair and I have never went to another barber from that day forward, bro, ever.
Oh, it's official. We out here.
I signed off on yours, bro. We good. Set up the chain.
You know, they tell everyone all the time, don't mix business with pleasure. Don't go into business with friends, things like that. And I 100% understand why. But I also understand that there are some things that you cannot explain or help someone feel. Like, there are some things that are just a feeling innately that you just know.
You can only trust a man of his word. And Philby's word is really good. You know, he's gonna tell you straight up. You know, it's not gonna be no fluff, no bullshit. He's gonna tell you how he feels. And that's what I love, is the honesty.
So we talked about it. He actually came to me about acquiring somebody else's barbershop at that time. And when he came to me about it, I was a little unsure on how he wanted to go about that. But then, you know, after one or two talks later, it was like, okay, so you want to do this for real? We're about to make this move, because I'm hyped. And you already know me, bro. I'll dive in. Like, you tell me we're going to do something and I think we could do it. And once I decide I'm going to do it, I'm going to do it. Like, it's a wrap. I'm going 100% in it.
I knew this is his bread and butter. Barbering is everything. This is how he takes care of his family. You know, I respected that he can be an entrepreneur and have a business and provide for his family. And I always knew that he wanted more, especially after the incident at Hair Junkies and we were gone. It was like, what now?
We already know we got our skills and we got the people who believe in us and support us. But the environment that you cut in feeds so much into the experience of getting your hair cut that we realize, like, we have to do our own thing, bro. Like, the only way to proceed to the levels that we want to see ourselves going is to have a foundation, have a home base. And right now we don't have that because we got to keep looking for a home base somewhere else.
We already knew that we work better alongside each other and we could bounce ideas off of each other like we do now still. And I knew that once I left Hair Junkies, I needed to open my own shop. And what better person to open a shop with the person that you've been cutting next to pretty much your whole career. I'm looking in downtown, I'm looking at all the busier roads. I find this spot and I'm like, I look online and I'm like, yo, this could work. You know, I presented to Philby and he's like, let's run with it.
Once we had a location, we had to get the inspection done so we could find out if we could actually have a barbershop in that location. EJ Nieves doing the mural was actually the driving force in us getting the keys as soon as we did to the location. I called EJ actually 2 times and he ignored my call both times.
Called him twice, you know, no answer, you know, so we were gonna go with plan B. You know, we weren't gonna wait on it if he didn't answer anything.
He happened to show up randomly at a event that me and Gonzo were hosting for back to school haircuts for kids.
And so I felt led to go over there and help out, but it was like a rainy day and I wasn't able to get there until like literally the end.
He pulled up at the time that he did and he was like, yo, I got space in my van, do y'all need help? And it was like, hell yeah, we need help.
Luckily that he did go to the back to school event, we were able to ask him in person rather than over the phone. And I feel like you get like a more genuine response whenever you're face to face with a person.
We were passing this location. And as we were passing, I looked at him on the highway and I was like, yo, follow me, I'm gonna show you something real quick. When we talked to EJ about doing the mural, we didn't even have the keys yet. We pulled up, we showed him through the window. So we're looking through the window like, yo, we're looking at getting this spot. If we get it, if we secure this spot, can you do the mural here?
He was so concise about like every piece of the puzzle to how this was gonna look like.
I don't think I told him that he had ignored my calls by this time. But I was like, I want you to do a mural here, what do you think? And he finally looked at it and was like, yo, I got crazy ideas. I kind of told him the main vibe was like galaxy space vibe.
We needed something off the top, you know, crazy. We needed something to set the bar and separate ourselves.
And I just knew, like, after being around all the art that I had been around and the vibes that it gives, like, I knew the barbershop had to have a mural, like a giant piece of art.
Custom piece? You know, a custom piece is different than anything that you can buy, you know, buy retail. We knew we wanted that flair, but we just didn't know what it was gonna be until EJ got involved.
The big thing was the mural. Like once we knew we could have EJ come to the mural, it was like.
And once we got the keys, EJ started working. You know, I think it was like the next day or something like that.
Hold on 1 minute, hold on. EJ's the guy. Everybody was here that Monday. First person I hit up was EJ.
I'm excited, bro.
Thinking about it now, I mean, it's funny. When I was doing it, at times it was a little frustrating.
Perfect, bro. This is gonna be perfect.
Yeah.
Cool. I'll start bringing myself.
Word. Yo, the only downside, I don't know how bad this affects you, we just found out that they're not gonna turn on the power for us.
We didn't even have power in here. It just started working. It was hot. Hot, hot, hot.
So, you know, usually there's power. Usually there's AC, if it's in an inside, you know, if it's outside, of course, you know we're outside. But for the most part, if it's an inside mural, like you're gonna have lights, you're gonna have AC. Nah, neither. I remember the end of day one, it was crazy because usually the first day is like when I go in and I'm like going hard and if it's a 10-hour day, it's a 10-hour day. If it's a 14-hour day, because I get in the rhythm of putting it up on the wall. I don't even look at the clock. Like, my phone's away. I'm not looking at clocks. But the funny thing is, nature has a funny way of telling you when it's dark outside. hour after hour, it just slowly got darker and slowly got darker to the point where I was painting in the dark, you know?
Be back here by like 12:30 tomorrow.
You too?
10, I can meet you at 10 on Friday.
Friday, yeah, cool. Okay.
Break.
Team Elevate.
Ooh.
So the main thing was the giant astronaut. Like, he sent me a picture of a giant astronaut, and then, you know, like a rough, way more rough, different version of what you see here.
We asked for Galaxy, something space theme. He came up with a mock-up, you know, a mock-up like right before he started. And that's whenever we seen the astronaut.
Then I started to think, and first of all, it was midnight. I was already half asleep. I was like, bro, whatever, dog. Like, all right, I'll see you tomorrow. Like, right? Like, that's like halfway what I'm thinking.
We want you to have creative freedom. I was like, you can't have an artist do something and not let them be free with what they're doing. They're not gonna enjoy it. They're not gonna like it. They're not gonna think this is their work.
But then I'm also thinking, like, damn, this could be fire, like a giant white astronaut. We got white chairs, we got the white toolboxes. I already know I wanna do black walls. Like, this could be crazy. We definitely noticed that the parts that he put Galaxy on were fire and we loved them. And that was the main thing I wanted, especially, I know Gonzo did, especially me, was like more Galaxy. So that's like our inside joke now whenever we're doing anything is more Galaxy, bro.
We knew that we wanted him to do his thing.
Just more Galaxy.
We don't give a fuck, but just more Galaxy. That was crazy. But that was the funny part. And it was like, we want him to do his thing because we know what he can do. He's done fucking murals all over town. We know the capabilities this man has.
But in my head, it was just like, my idea originally was just Galaxy. Like just a wall that just looked like Galaxy, like nothing else. But he made it an art piece.
So the Galaxy, at the time, I thought it would be unbalanced if I added more.
That was like one of the funniest moments of the whole thing is because we had just talked about putting more Galaxy.
We wanted more. He thought there was already too much. So it was like, I was like, oh, fuck.
Yeah, I don't want to overdo the Galaxy for sure. And we're like, no, we need you to overdo the Galaxy, dog. Do the Galaxy. So bringing up thoughts to EJ about his mural was always interesting because as an artist myself, I have a certain view on the artistry, but then as a client paying for custom artistry, I have a different perspective, and trying to ride that wall is interesting.
Yo, what's up? What's up?
The Galaxy, you know what? Is exactly when I told you we want this space theme.
Yeah.
That's what I want. Yeah. Galaxy, like that's fine.
No, I got you. I'm gonna add a little bit more because I don't want to overdo it. He would always present it like a question. He'd be like, "Well, how do you feel about that?" And in my mind, I'm like, "Bro, I feel great. You know, I'm the one that put it up there." But I read between the lines.
But I have this crazy idea to incorporate a little bit more.
Is that what you're on this side?
No, so it's gonna be, I'm gonna do some geometrical, like triangular type of triangle, so it's gonna look kind of mountainous.
But it was just like collaborating on the piece together rather than us telling him what to do.
But then I'm gonna drop the Galaxy inside of a mountainous shape. So that's the idea.
I almost never wanted to tell EJ anything about the painting. Because to a certain extent, it's like, this is his piece. We're paying for his artistry, and we want his vibe and his flavor. But then we're also paying for a piece for our barbershop that we want to reflect our shop and the vibe that we also wanted to give out. So it's really a collaborative effort.
Real chill, because I don't want to overdo it.
Be an artist anyway, we already know how that goes. So we want to give you as much freedom and you be as comfortable as you can be.
Hey, that works great.
Cool.
As long as you get that elevate.
Oh yeah.
You don't want to force your vision onto the artist and then it not even be an organic flow because it's not at all what they were trying to do. You know what I mean? And so it's like, I don't know, bro. I felt like at that day, I was like, yo, I feel like I had already put too much input in to EJ, and I was like, yo, I already told him too much stuff, bro. You gotta tell him this, bro. Like, I can't be the guy again. I can't fuck up his vibe. Like,
so we were like, okay, how do we tell him? How do we tell him that we want him to change his vision a little bit?
I was like, you know what? I'm gonna add more Galaxy because in my head, I'm like, bro, I could just spray paint over it if I don't like it.
In the end, we got it, you know, and he executed it perfectly.
I came back in like, damn, all right, we got more Galaxy.
And it actually added. I mean, it added to the beauty of it. It added to the balance and made it kind of continue on a lot more than I thought I wanted. But when I saw it, I was like, yeah, this makes complete sense.
They understood each other well enough. I don't even need to be there for that conversation, but it worked out perfect.
Gonzo, you know, would be like, hey man, like, how do you feel about the pink? And in my mind, it was like code for, I don't really want the pink.
I didn't mind the pink. I liked the pink at first.
I swapped it out with like a lavender because I knew I was going in with a darker purple. And once I did that, everything changed.
Now that I have this piece up, or we have this piece up, it's like, could you think of a better piece for this? Because I can't. Like, it's perfect, bro.
That's better than I could have ever thought of. Better than any Galaxy little photo that I would have thought of, you know? And that's why you get artists involved and you get people like that involved, because they can bring a whole different perspective.
So, you know, it was a team effort. You know, a little pushback created a masterpiece. Me as an artist, there are a couple things that I absolutely love, and it is almost impossible for me to break from, and that's balance. My pieces have to have balance, and that is whether it's color, you know, color that floats on the left might need to float a little bit on the right. Maybe the piece is a little heavier on the left than the right. Some artists don't care about that. Some artists love that. They love to have a piece of artwork look heavy. For me, I think it's just a testament to the things that I desire for my life is balance. Pretty much 10 years in now, doing this professionally. So I would say the biggest obstacle that I had to overcome was the fear that I was putting within myself, on my own life and my own career. The fear comes, but it's never crippling now. It's a reminder now that it, like, as we elevate, you know, we have to make sure that we're sharpening ourselves to be the best, like, the best person that we can be, the best artist, the best, you know, entrepreneur, whatever it is that we're engulfed in. And in my life, of course, like, as an artist and as a gallery owner, I always need to sharpen, like, myself to be the best that I can. One thing that I've always found very profound about an artist, and to me, an artist is anybody that can manifest anything from here or here, right? Manifest it and create it. It could be literally anything that's manifested. To me, that's artistry. We need a place where that can happen. Artists, prodigies, you know, young minds, young artists that are intrigued by the arts, all the way to prodigies can go and be blessed and be poured into within their heart's desire for art, no matter what it is. I was really gonna play off of like the surface of like the moon or the surface of some planet that we've never like discovered, you know, with, you know, nebula in the background. But I kept thinking to myself, I want there to be something larger than life. And yeah, you can put a planet on there, but a planet is very predictable. A planet is just kind of what everybody would think to do. And then I thought, okay, well, what if we put an astronaut there? An astronaut as well is something that is very predictable, but for me, it had to do with the style. So for me, when I started to design it and I started to apply it on the wall, I knew that I wanted the astronaut to be displayed in a way that it really hasn't been before. Ultimately, a style was born here called shock style. And it's like sharp and blocky. So I kind of just mashed it together.
To be able to know that we're a part of the initial journey of his mural style, that feels awesome, bro. It feels great to know that we have that. And everyone who comes in here loves it. Like, everyone who comes in to get a cut, it's the first thing they say is like, man, that's incredible. I can't believe it. It's even more funny to me when people come in and they're here for like half an hour and then everybody's quiet, and all of a sudden they're like, oh shit, it's an astronaut. It's like, bro, you've been here for half an hour and you just realized it's an astronaut? Like, yeah, they're like, I was just looking at so many different things, I didn't even step back to look at it. And it's like, yeah, bro, that shit is raw, bro. That shit is raw.
He created something that we didn't even think could be possible, you know? And we're grateful for it because now we get to see it every day. Our clients get to see it every day, and shit, the content is gonna be nuts.
Man, it was worth it, bro, because now when you sit in here and it just feels like a real unique space, bro. And honestly, that's the number one thing I wanted it to feel like. I wanted when you come in here and you sit in this chair and you're getting your hair cut to look around and feel like you're not in just a regular old space. Like, to like look at the mural and feel the vibes and our energy and know that like this isn't your typical place where you get your hair cut.
So again, a little bit of this created, you know, beauty.
My goal was to have a barbershop. Obviously, it's easy to build a simple barbershop, basic barbershop. But whenever you bring a person like Philby involved that has a lot of ideas, has a lot of imagination and a lot of ideas, you know? So you bring a person like that into your business and you combine each other, you know?
Me and him doing the shop, EJ doing the mural, and then all of us being able to really appreciate the experience of seeing something come together and like the birth of a whole new endeavor and project and see all these pieces flow together so perfectly and then be able to support each other. It's been a beautiful thing, man.
You could be an entrepreneur, you could work for yourself, and you could build yourself up by being just a barber, you know? And the sky's the limit. You know, whatever you do is up to you. It's just what you do with your time and your craft.
Many people are not able to capture and capitalize their own thoughts and their own visions to manifest something. There's a lot of people that aren't able to do that. That's a skill. I believe anybody can learn it, but there is a small percentage of people that it's like innate. And Philby and Gonzo, it's an innate sense. Like you don't see this like that. Like for somebody to say, I'm gonna open up a barbershop and literally 2 months later, 3 months later it happens, that people talk about these things for years and then they never do it.
If you're constantly striving to be better, you're always going to have to start over. And now I'm just starting over. You know what I mean? I've done this, I'm 30 now. I've done this my whole life. I know what starting over is like. And then I know I'm gonna elevate again and start over again. And every time I start over, it's just to elevate to a new level.
For Ocala to be, you know, the fastest growing, you know, city in the country, and for us to be at the forefront of it, we're on one of the busiest roads, Ocala is gonna grow. I think to on the levels of where Orlando is, but we're at that level where Ocala's not there yet, and we're not there yet. We're starting where Ocala is now, and as we grow and Ocala grows, we'll be as successful as Ocala is, and this is only the beginning. Only the beginning.
I gotta elevate. I've been praying to God for a better way. I concentrate on my goals and I meditate. Make sacrifices, put time and I dedicate. I gotta elevate. I'ma make sure the family forever straight. They wouldn't listen, now I gotta devastate. I'm on your ass and I won't let you get away. I gotta elevate. I've been praying to God for a better way. I concentrate on my goals and I meditate. Make sacrifices, put time and I dedicate. I gotta elevate. I'ma make sure the family forever straight. They wouldn't listen, now I gotta devastate. I'm on your ass and I won't let you get away. I gotta elevate. These niggas doubted me, but I won't give up on myself. This me in the trap. I-